أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله بارئ الخلائق أجمعين، ثم الصلاة والسلام على المبعوث رحمة للعالمين، سيدي وحبيبي ونور قلبي، طب القلوب ودوائها، وعافية الأبدان وشفائها، ونور الأبصار وضيائها، أبي القاسم محمد، اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين الهاديين المهديين الذين أذاب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا، اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. أما بعد، فقد قال الله سبحانه وتعالى في محكم تنزيله: بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن المسلمين والمسلمات والمؤمنين والمؤمنات والقانتين والقانتات والصادقين والصادقات والصابرين والصابرات والخاشعين والخاشعات والمتصدقين والمتصدقات والصائمين والصائمات والحافظين فروجهم والحافظات والذاكرين الله كثيرا والذاكرات، أعد الله لهم مغفرة وأجرا عظيما. صدق الله العلي العظيم. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. عباد الله، أوصيكم ونفسي بتقوى الله. My dear brothers, dear sisters, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته. In the beginning, we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for all His blessings, which are uncountable if we are to count them. We thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and grateful for all blessings He already gave and the ones to give and the ones He continue to give every single minute. Ya Allah, thank you for all of them, the ones we can remember and the ones we cannot remember. Thank you for all of those beautiful blessings, Ya Rabbal Alameen. And we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for all His mercy and blessings of guiding us to His path and making us to be those who are Muslims. There is no greater blessing than to find yourself being a Muslim. And that is why in dua we read, Alhamdulillahi alladhi hadana lihada wa ma kunna linahtadiya lawla an hadana Allah. All praise belongs to Allah for guiding us to this religion, coming to know Allah, know the Prophet, know Ahlul Bayt. If not because of His guidance, we wouldn't have found Allah or the Prophet or Ahlul Bayt. Ya Allah, thank you for this guidance. And we send our salutation and respect to our leader, our mentor, our Prophet, Ar-Rasulul A'zam, sallallahu alayhi wa alihi. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa alihi. Peace and blessing of Allah be upon him. And may the blessing and peace of Allah be upon his household, the progeny, the family, the descendant of the Prophet, the chosen ones, the purified ones. And may the Almighty Allah count us among the true followers of Prophet Muhammad and his household, Ya Rabbal Alameen. My dear brothers and sisters, another important day we're given to remind one another about Allah. Every Friday is another great day we're given to remind one another about the best thing in life, which is Taqwallah. Taqwallah, the fear of Allah, being God conscious, is one of the best things one needs in this life and hereafter. To live a life of peace in this world, you need Taqwallah. You live to live a life of peace in Barzakh, you need a taqwa Allah. To live peacefully yawm al-qiyamah, you need a taqwa Allah. When you look at the list of Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam, they emphasize about the importance of taqwa in all these stages of life. But one of the ayahs in the Quran which reminds us about the importance of taqwa, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَتَزَوَّدُوا فَإِنَّ خَيْرَ الزَّادِ التَّقْوَى. Seek provisions for your journey to your barzakh. Take provisions. Work hard to take with you some things. Then Allah tells you what is the best thing for you in barzakh in yawm al-qiyamah. And He says, فَإِنَّ خَيْرَ الزَّادِ. The best of all, وَالتَّقْوَى. That is the best in Yawm al-Qiyamah. When we pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless us with taqwa Yawm al-Qiyamah, Ya Rabb al-Alameen. And help us to live a life of taqwa, Ya Rabb al-Alameen. My dear brothers and sisters, today our khutbah is about the role of some women in Islam. As you know, we are observing the day of Ummul Baneen, the mother of Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas and Ja'far and Abdullah and Uthman, the children of Imam Ali alayhi salam. More often we don't talk about certain women in Islam. Now we know for sure there are certain women, we know they're great women. They are not at the level anybody can match with them. Such as Fatima salamullahi alayha. Allahumma salli ala. Or Khadija alayhi salam, or Asiya bint Muzahim, or Maryam alayhi salam. These women, we all know how great they are. But there are certain other women in Islam who also played a big role in Islam. But we hardly talk about them. We hardly discuss about them. We hardly even learn about them, even though they are also great women and they can be an example for all of us. And today we want to talk about some of them as we observe the death of Ummul Baneen alayhi salam, this great woman. The ayah we just read is in Surah Al-Ahzab, ayah 35, which was revealed upon the Prophet in the early stage of Islam. And this ayah was revealed in regarding a woman known as Asma bint Umays, a great lady, great woman. How was she great? She stood by her husband at the time of difficulty. When men are running back, she was running in front to be next to her husband to do what pleases Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This woman, as you know, at the early stage of Islam, Muslims have been through so much. Today, you and I think being a Muslim is so difficult. It's good to go back and read the Islamic history. And that will give you some sense and some understanding and some eye-opening about how difficult this Islam was at the early stage of Islam. But people were able to endure all of that and go through that and bring this Islam to you and I today. And one of the challenges that Muslims went through at the early stage of Islam was the poor people among the Arabs back in those days. As you know, the tribes of Arabs at the time of the Prophet, they divided into three categories. Category number one are the group of Arabs who are known to be powerful Arabs. They have the large numbers. They're known to have so many children, so many men. So those people are kind of, nobody can touch them. Because they're men. That's why Arabs, they're always proud of having a child, a boy. Right? So if you have a lot of boys, nobody will mess with you. So if you have a tribe where you have a lot of boys, you know, you are safe. Nobody will touch you. You do whatever you want to do. That's number one. Number two, some group, no, you might not have a lot of boys, but if you have a lot of money, then nobody will touch you. You're safe. But if you happen to be, you came from the poor family, you don't have money, and now you have a large numbers, then you are the victim of the society back in those days. So back in those days, the poor people among the Arabs were punished, were tortured, were killed, were imprisoned, and you name it. And one of them is Bilal al-Habashi. Bilal al-Habashi came from Ethiopia, didn't have money, didn't have any tribe, he was alone, so he was one of the victims. Now, not just he was one of the victims, there are other Arabs too. But because they also coming from small group of Arabs, they don't have money, they too fall into the victims. So what happened? They started torturing them, punishing them, hitting them, doing all sort of things. So what happened? Our Prophet Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad, gathered those poor ones, those weaker ones among them, and he said to them, I want to suggest to you something. And my suggestion is, you should do hijrah to Africa. Leave and move to the land of Habasha, Abyssinia. Because there is a leader there who will not do any injustice to anyone. And this king is known as Najashi. What a great man. You know, from the history wise, this Najashi, after he became Muslim, he sent one of his sons to Medina to learn Islam so he can come back and teach the people of Ethiopia. When he went there, his son, he settled there, he got married, he has children, and guess what? From the history perspective, one of the grandsons of Najashi was even in Karbala with Imam Hussein alayhi salam. He participated in Karbala with Imam Hussein alayhi salam from the lineage of Najashi. Now, so the Prophet, when he told those weak ones among the Arabs to migrate to Abyssinia, they all agreed, the poor ones, they said, we will, Ya Rasulullah, because the pain and the agony and the suffering is too much. So they did. The leader of them, the Prophet chose the leader who is known as Ja'far ibn Abi Talib to be the leader. Ja'far, his wife, is called Asma bint Umays, the one that we're talking about. She is the reason why this ayah was revealed upon the Prophet. She went with the Prophet to Ethiopia. They stayed there for a while, enduring all kind of difficulties, staying away from home. And many of us, we can relate to this, homesick, right? Those of us who came here early and 50 years ago, 45 years ago, they have challenges that they have to face in this country. Selling food, you cannot find it. Your favorite drinks, you cannot find it. And you have to endure all of that. These companions of the Prophet, when they moved to Abyssinia, they have to face all of that. They stay there for a while, and then after things calm down, the Prophet told them, you can come back. And they came back. When they came back to Medina, this woman, Asma bint Umays, she ran to the house of the Prophet. And she went to one of the wives. And she said, did any ayah was revealed regarding women? Then the first wife said, no, not that I know of. She went to another one. Did you have any ayah revealed upon the Prophet which talks about women and their sacrifice, going to Abyssinia, leaving their homeland, leaving their loved ones? Did any verse was revealed? She said, no, not that I know of. Nothing like that I heard. No, I have seen anything such. She went to another one. By any chance, did you hear from Rasulullah any verse that came regarding women who sacrificed with their husbands, leaving Mecca to go to Abyssinia, stay with their husbands, and make all these sacrifices? She said, no, sorry, I didn't hear anything. After testing many of these wives, she said, look, now let me go straight to the Prophet himself. She went straight to the Prophet. Ya Rasulullah, I have a question for you. He said, go ahead, what's your question? Ya Rasulullah, did you receive any verse from Allah regarding women who sacrificed their life, their time, their energy, their country, their family,
and left everything and went to Abyssinia for the sake of Islam. Did you get any verse in the Quran in such regards? The Prophet says, no. She said, okay. Here's my final say, Ya Rasulullah. I said, we women, we have zero blessing from Islam. You have nothing. I said, why? Ya Rasulullah, we hear verses in the Quran talks about women and their men and their sacrifice, their jihad. When they die, they go into Jannah. The blessing Allah has prepared for them. What about us? Then the Prophet was listening to her. Immediately this ayah was revealed in Surah Al-Ahzab. Ya Rasulullah, calm her down. Tell her to come down. It's not what she thinks. The matter is absolutely different than what she's thinking. What is it? Then the ayah was revealed. Inna al-Muslimin wal-Muslimat. Wal-Mu'mineen wal-Mu'minat. Wal-Qanitin wal-Qanitat. Allah then mentioned 10 qualities of male and female next to one another. When this woman heard about it, you know, you see when a flower is dying, right? And then you suddenly, because she's lacking water, and then you give it a water, and then suddenly you started getting life back, right? Asma, when this eye was revealed and she heard it, as if she was dying, and now she's reviving back. She looked at the Prophet, and she said, Ya Rasulullah, now I can feel something in my heart about Islam. Now I can sense some happiness in my heart. What? So the ayah was revealed in answering to those who say that Islam has no, women have no voice in Islam. For those Christians and non-Muslims who think that Islam is a religion of dictatorship and religion is the religion of Islam, is a religion of men and not the women, they should listen to this verse. A woman was the one who was the reason this ayah was revealed. So Allah told her, Ya Asma'a bint Umays, let it be known to you that in the sight of Allah, there is no difference between a man and a woman. In the sight of Allah, a man and a woman are equal. The difference between a man and a woman is when it comes to the responsibilities. When a man does whatever he does in terms of coming closer to Allah, he gets the same reward in front of Allah as if the man did the same thing. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to clarify that, these 10 qualities can be divided into 3 categories. Category number 1, that Islam is about 3 things. Number 1, it's called al-iqrar bil lisan. What you say with your mouth, with your tongue. That's number 1. And number 2, at-tasdiq bil qalb. You confirm what you said with your heart. That's 2. And number 3, you practice what you say and believe in your heart. These are the 3 stages of Islam. For that matter, Islam is about what I say and what I believe and what I practice. Right? Now all of these 3 can be found in these 10 qualities that Quran mentioned. Now number 1, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Al-Muslimin wal-Muslimat. You know, Al-Muslim is what? The one who verbally said, I denounce everything to be God except Allah. Nothing is worthy to become God except Allah. It's called Muslim. Iqrar bil lisan. Now, this iqrar bil lisan is not enough. You have to show in your actions. You have to prove it. Then Allah says, وَالْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَالْمُؤْمِنَاتِ وَالْقَانِتِينَ وَالْقَانِتَ. This 2 part comes to prove that saying that I believe without following with the wa, with the internal belief, it doesn't mean anything to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And iman is what? I say something, now it's sitting in my heart. That's why Quran in Surah Al-A'raf and Surah in Surah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about, where he says, the Arab, the Bedouins, when they came to Rasulullah and they said, we believe. Allah said, no, قالت الأعراب آمنا قل لم تؤمنوا ولكن قولوا أسلمنا ولما يدخل الإيمان في قلوبكم. The difference between Islam and Iman is that Islam is in your mouth. I say that, but it's no longer sitting in my heart. Right? Now, when that, what you say, sits in your heart, then it becomes Iman. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, whatever you say, I believe in Allah, I believe in the Prophet, I believe in Ahlul Bayt, that is your words. But it has to go from that to sitting in your heart, which is called an Iman wal Qunut. And that is the second part. Now, after I believe in that, after it has sit in my heart, is that enough? Quran said, no, no. Then it has to follow with the practice and actions. So, I said it, it sit in my heart, but I'm not doing anything. Islam says it doesn't mean anything to Allah. That is why in Surah Al-Asr, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَالْعَصْرْ إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَفِي خُسْرٍ إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَأَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ. They believe. It's not enough. But it has to follow with the actions. وَأَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ. So the ayah tells us that المسلمين والمسلمات. And by the way, a Muslim comes in different stages too. A Muslim is not one stage. One stage of Islam, the Prophet says, المسلم من سلم المسلمون من لسانه ويده. A true Muslim is not the person who says, أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن محمد رسول الله. No. A true Muslim is when people become safe from your tongue and your action. That's one of the signs of a Muslim. Now, when we say, I'm a Muslim, yes, you can be a Muslim. But if I hurt people with my tongue, with my action, that doesn't make you a Muslim. And Islam is more about action. Where a person, not just my words, my actions too. Now, not only that this is Islam, then there is al-Iman, also comes in different stages too. Al-Qunut, when a person also digests things in their mind, in their heart. Then Allah said, was-sadiqeen. Then Allah mentioned another three important stages of akhlaq, which is very important as a Muslim. As-sadiqeen comes to say, now, I believe in Allah. I say that I now have it in my heart. But one thing you have to do is what? To be a true mu'min, you have to guard your tongue as well. Your tongue can be one of the most dangerous items that can take you to hellfire. This tongue, as you see it, as small as it is, right, it's one of the worst things that you can use for your on yourself. That's why Imam Ali says, لِسَانُكَ أَسَدُ إِنْ أَطْلَقْتَهُ أَكَلَتْكَ. See, your tongue is your lion. If you let it loose, it will come and eat you. It's not going to eat you physically, but it's going to eat you action-wise. This tongue is one of the dangerous things. And that is why in Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has taught us in many verses how to guard this tongue and protect it. That's why the next ayah Allah says, وَالصَّادِقِينَ وَالصَّادِقَاتِ. A true mu'min, after you believe in Allah, you constantly watch what comes out of your mouth. What you say to others. How you say to others, these are part of the Iman. That is wasadiqeen. Then after that, Allah said, wasabireen. The next quality are the people who understood that this life comes with challenges. Life is never going to be easy to anybody. And we all have to be tested one way or another. But when that challenge comes in my way, what do I need to do? I need to exercise patience, as sabr. Many things will come in life, you don't like it. And sometimes it's going to be in your own lines of circle of family. They do things, they say things, sometimes your own children. Sometimes your own brother. Sometimes your partner in life. Sometimes your neighbor. Sometimes your relatives. But what are you going to do? You have to exercise patience. Allah tells you in the Quran, وَكَذَلِكَ جَعَلْنَا بَعْضُكُمْ لِبَعْضٍ عَدُوٌ فِتْنَةٌ أَتَسْبِرُونَ. Allah said, we made some of you to be your test to see how patient you're going to be. As-sabr, when you're able to stand on your feet, to control your anger, to control things that bothers you, things that troubles you in life. He said, that is part of it. وَالْخَاشِعِينَ وَالْخَاشِعَاتِ. Al-khushu'a. It's a sign of also completely surrendering to Allah through the knowledge that you gain about Allah. Al-khushu' in Arabic, when we say al-khushu' from the khasha'a, al-khushu' is to get to become humble in front of someone because of the knowledge you gain about them. When we say a person is khashya, he fears Allah. But that fear comes from the knowledge. Now, if the fear comes from something else, it's not called khushu, it's called khawf. That's why in Quran Allah says, إِنَّمَا يَخْشَ اللَّهَ مِنْ عِبَادِهِ الْعُلَمَاء. Allah said, those who get the khushu are the people who have knowledge. That's khushu. Always come with the ilm and knowledge that you gain about something. Allah said, wal khashi'in, people who have internal fear of Allah because of the knowledge they have gained about Allah. Then he said, wal mutasaddiqin, those who constantly give for the sake of Allah. They don't have to wait to have a lot to share with others. Whatever little they have, whatever is needed, whatever they can do, they share that with those who may need. Then Allah says another important thing. As we mentioned, the danger of the mouth. As they say, there are three things. If you want to go to Jannah, you have to look for them every part of your life. Number one, your tongue. Number two, your stomach, what you put in it. Number three, your private part. These three things, if you don't take care of them, any one of them, can lead you to hellfire easily. That's why Imam al-Ridha alayhi salam, Allahumma salli ala. One day a man came to him. He said to him, Yabna Rasulillah, what can you tell me to do in order to earn to Jannah easily? Imam held his tongue like this. He said, observe these and I will guarantee you Jannah. If you can take care of this tongue, he said, you got the Jannah. Allahu Akbar. And this is not a joke. You put what Imam said to Quran. Allah said, Yawm al-Qiyamah, al-Yawm nakhtimu ala afwahihim. On the day of Qiyamah, this mouth that kept talking 24-7, Allah said, we will close it, seal it. That's it. Ya Rab, I used to talk. Yes, then, now, no. That is the danger of the tongue. Now, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, I guided my tongue. By the ayah says, wal wasadiqeen. Now they say, wasa'imeen. Those who protect their stomach with the siyam. They don't just put things in their stomach for the sake of putting. They don't just eat because it's there. They don't just eat because I'm giving. They always guard and watch what comes in order to put in their mouth. They want to make sure that whatever they digest, they eat, is coming from halal and is only halal. And not only is halal in terms of buying, it's halal in terms of Allah's allowing them to do it, to eat it. And that is wasa'imin wa sa'imat. Then the last one is wal hafidhina li furujahum. Those who observe their private part. They're very protective of themselves. Wal hafidhat, and the women as well. And the last one, Allah said, wadhakirin Allah kathira. Those who constantly in remembrance of Allah. Al-Dhakirin. If you look at all the 10 qualities, Allah just mentioned them one time and nothing is added to it except the dhikr. When Allah reached to talk about dhikr, he said, Wadhakirin Allah كَثِيرًا. Those who remember Allah a lot. Ya Allah, what is Allah to you? Now I just want you to think about, when we say Allah, to me, is that 100? Is that 1,000? Is that 1,000,000? Is that 1,000,000,000? Is that 1,000,000,000,000? What is Allah to me? Alright? Now it's not about you, it's about Allah. Allah, when He says, كَثِير. Now understand Allah to Allah. From the Quranic point of view. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He looks in this dunya and what exists in them, Allah says, mata'un qaleel. Ya Allah, this world, the trees, the galaxies, the moon, the sun, the human, Allah says, no, these are all something little. The same Allah in the Quran says, وَالذَّاكِرِينَ اللَّهَ كَثِيرًا. Ya Allah, what is Allah to you? This hadith comes to explain. الَّذِينَ يَذْكُرُونَ اللَّهَ قِيَامًا وَقُعُودًا وَأَلَى جُنُوبِهِ. Those who remember Allah when they stand, when they sit, and when they recline, when they lay down. Because human being, you have only three situations you can ever be in. One is either you stand in, or you sit in, or you recline. Nothing more than that. Allah said, الذاكرين الله كثيرا, are the people, every situation they find themselves in, they have Allah in their mind. والذاكرين الله كثيرا. And dhikr of Allah is not just with the tongue. Just having Allah's consciousness with you is dhikr. Just thinking about Allah, thinking your position in the sight of Allah is part of the dhikr. Then Allah says, أَعَدَّ اللَّهُ لَهُمْ أَجْرًا عَظِيمًا. Allah says, yes, all of these people with all of these qualities, Allah says, we have prepared for them the greatest reward, يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. This is whether it's a male or female. Now, one of the women that have lived to be in that level is Umm al-Baneen. This woman, we don't talk about her more often. But this woman, she has sacrificed for Islam and played a big role in Islam. Unfortunately, it doesn't have to be that we remember on the day of her death or her wafat. No, it should be that this woman should be a center of our lessons. This woman, she came in the picture after Fatima al-Zahra's matrimony. So, ya Allah. When Zahra salamullah alayhi, she suggested to Imam Ali, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, please get married after my demise, after my majdul, get married. I want somebody to be a mother to my children. Imam Ali alayhi salam, in following the advice of Zahra, he is called his brother and is known as Aqil ibn Abi Talib. Aqil was known as the one of the specialists in genealogy. And a special Arab gene, he knows it. Aqil can look at someone and he can tell you your father, your grandfather, your lineage. That's how expert he was. That's one of the gifts that Allah gave Aqil. And Imam Ali told him, Ya Aqil, can you suggest a good woman for me? No, here's the thing. Imam Ali doesn't know that. Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, you are the teacher of everyone. Why do you have to ask someone? Why don't you look and find yourself somebody who deserves you as a husband? Imam Ali knew. But you know, Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam, sometimes they do things to teach us something. There are many examples in the Quran. One simple example of these is like when Sulaiman was asking somebody to bring the throne of Balqis. You think he cannot do that? When he says in the Quran, أَيُّكُمْ يَأْتِينِي بِعَرْشِهَا قَبْلَ أَنْ يَأْتُونِي مُسْلِمِينَ. You think he doesn't have the power? Of course he does. But why does he have to ask someone to do that? He wants to teach the people and the surrounding about certain important figures around them that they need to know and take advantage of them. Imam Ali knew. He can figure out who is the best, right? Nobody told Imam Ali to go for Zahra alayhi salam. He himself, he wanted to go to the Prophet. Why would he ask somebody about somebody that he wants to marry? When he went to his brother, Aqil said, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, What kind of woman are you looking for? He said, ابحث لي امرأة ولدتها الفحول من فحول العرب لتلد لي غلاما ينصر ولدي الحسين في يوم عاشوراء. Look, Imam Ali عليه السلام, he's getting married, but he's not thinking about him. His goal of the marriage is Karbala. His intention of the marriage, someone to be there for his son on that day when he will not be able to be there, when Zahra is not going to be there, when the Prophet is not going to be there, when Imam Hassan cannot be there. They need somebody to be there. So the marriage of Imam Ali was not about him. He was thinking about Karbala. Then Aqil told him, عليك بفاطمة الكلابية. The best one in this description that you just told me, the one that fit, is this woman. Imam Ali عليه السلام took his suggestions. When he went to Fatima bint Asad and approached her for marriage, Ya Fatima, I want you to become, I want to marry you. I'm asking your hand for marriage. The first thing she said, no, Ya Amir. But no, not know that I don't want you. No, know that I cannot be a wife to you. What do you mean you can't be a wife to me? She is referring that a house where Fatima lived in it, I cannot come in and be a wife in that level with her. I'm not a match. So what do you mean? She says, I can only come as a servant, not the title of wife. She says, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, the only way that I can allow is if you accept me as a servant, then I'm coming. But as a wife, no, I can't meet the shoes of Zahra. I cannot enter in that shoe. And indeed, she's telling the truth. No one can stand as a match for Zahra salamu alayhi wa sallam. Imam Ali says, if that's what you want done, you can come as a servant. This woman, as she came, before she came, she told Imam Ali, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, now I understand you want me to come, right? But I want you to ask Imam al-Hasan and Hussein and Zainab, that are they accepting me to become as a servant in that house? Allahu Akbar. Really, if you talk about the ayah when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, ayat al-mawadda, when Allah قُلْ لَا أَسْأَلُكُمْ عَلَيْهِ أَجْرًا إِلَّا الْمَوَدَّةَ فِي الْقُرْبَى, this woman is the example of the love and compassion of Ahlul Bayt. She is the symbol of it. She said, I want Imam al-Hasan and Hussein to also accept that they want me as a servant. Imam Ali said, they accept. No, no, no. I want them to say it. Imam Ali asked her, al-Hasan, of course, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen. She's absolutely welcome. This woman married Imam Ali. And as she came to the house, she never did anything in that house to hurt Imam al-Hasan or Imam al-Hussein or Zainab. As a matter of fact, whenever she sees something is going to trouble them, she rushed to stay away from it. The reason why she's called Umm al-Baneen, because she says, look at how observant she was in the house. She says, when Imam Ali called her, Ya Fatima, in the house, she is responding, but her eyes on Imam al-Hasan and Hussein. One day Imam Ali came from the masjid. She said, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, I want you to change my name. Why change your name? She said, because every time you say Fatima, I see the face of Hassan and Hussein, as if they remember their mother, and they become sad. And I don't want to be the one to put that sorrow in their heart. Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, change my name, call me something different. That's when Imam Ali says, Ummul Bani, the mother of sons. And Allah bless her with four sons. The older one is Abbas, then Ja'far, then Abdullah, then Uthman, and all of these children were sacrificed for Imam Hussein under the Afar Shura. Exactly like dua of Imam Ali from day one when he wanted to get married. Yansur waladi al Hussein fi yom Ashura. All of them, they sacrificed and they gave their life to Imam Hussein alayhi salam on that day. And even when the news came to Medina that Karbala took place, Imam Hussein was murdered, she didn't want to hear anything about her sons. She wanted to hear about Imam Hussein alayhi salam. What a great woman. What a great woman. What a woman as an example for all of us. Peace be upon her on the day she died. And peace be upon her on the day she will be resurrected. May the Almighty Allah give her the highest position in Jannah, Ya Rabbal Alameen. And grant all of us the shafa of Ummul Baneen, Ya Rabbal Alameen. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Inna atayinaka al-kawthar. Fasalli lirabbika wanhar. Inna shani'aka huwa al-abtar. Sallu ala Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على محمد وآل محمد اللهم صل على محمد اللهم صل وسلم على أئمة المسلمين علي بن أبي طالب وصل على فاطمة الزهراء سيدة نساء العالمين وعلى الحسن والحسين سيدي شباب أهل الجنة أجمعين اللهم صل على أئمة المسلمين علي بن الحسين زين العابدين ومحمد بن علي باقر علم النبيين وجعفر بن محمد الصادق وموسى بن جعفر الكاظم وعلي بن موسى الرضا ومحمد بن علي الجواد وعلي بن محمد الهادي والحسن بن علي العسكري والحجة بن الحسن المهدي حججك على عبادك اللهم عجل لوليك الفرج اللهم عجل لوليك الفرج واجعلنا من أعوانهم وأنصاره ومن المستشهدين بين يديه جميعا ورحمة الله وبركاته الله My dear brothers and sisters, one of the events of this week, I would like to wish each and every one of you a happy new year. May the Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bring this new year into all of your life with progress, prosperity, and development, and spiritual uplifting, inshallah. I know a lot of people, sometimes they say, why do we have to say Happy New Year? Our new year is Islamic calendar. You know, but you have to be realistic to yourself, my dear brother. Your birthday is about this calendar. You get paid by this calendar. You live according to this calendar. And then you say, why should I celebrate this birthday? The reality is, well, our life is based on this calendar. Yes, we have Islamic calendar, no doubt. But who get paid on Hijri calendar? Tell me. Now today, if you ask an average Muslim, when is your birthday by Islamic Hijri? How many of us can tell that? Huh? But today, if you ask me, oh, what is your birthday? Exactly, you're going to tell me Gregorian calendar. Your life is based on this calendar, right? And by the way, if we're talking about this calendar is based on the birth of Isa alayhi salam, who has right upon Isa more than Muslims? We have the right more on Isa more than anybody else. Because Quran says in Surah Al-Baqarah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, you cannot be considered a muttaqi unless you believe in the books that were sent before Prophet Muhammad. And he's one of them. وَالَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِمَا أُنزِلَ إِلَيْكَ وَمَا أُنزِلَ مِنْ قَبْلِكَ And Isa is one of them too. So we cannot deny that fact. Now, if you want to live according to the Hijri, please go ahead. But we know that Isa is one of us. So I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that every year comes with progress and development and knowledge and spiritual uplifting in all of your lives and your families, inshallah. Last not the least also is about the flood that happened in California, where a lot of people have a lot of damages and a lot of people lost so many properties. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make it easy for all of them, Ya Rabbal Alameen. Ya Allah, we ask you, we are brothers and sisters who are sick, give them the fastest recovery, Ya Rabbal Alameen. We are brothers and sisters, Ya Allah, those who are in the hospitals, Ya Allah, give them the fastest recovery, Ya Rabbal Alameen. Brothers, sisters, those who are going through difficulty, Ya Allah, make it easy for all of them, Ya Rabbal Alameen. Our marhumin, marhumat, Ya Allah, be pleased with all of them, Ya Rabbal Alameen. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, inna atainaka al-kawthar, fasalli li rabbika wanhar, inna shani'aka huwa al-abtar, sallu ala Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad. الله أكبر الله أكبر أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن محمد